Welcome, everyone. My name is Donna Rapaccioli, and I have the privilege of serving as the Dean of the Gabelli School of Business. Thank you all for joining us on today's webinar. I also want to thank our co-sponsors, the CFA Society of New York and the Museum of American Finance. I especially want to thank our speaker, Charles Gorra, and Andrea Manillo, who will guide this conversation today. I want to step back a moment and remind you that 2020 marks an important time for the Gabelli School of Business. It marks 100 years of purpose-driven business education at Fordham. Our year started with an event celebrating historic sustainable business partnership with PVH Corp, the parent company of the global fashion brands that many of you know, Izod, Calvin Klein, Van Heusen, and more. Our centennial celebration continued in March when we hosted the conference, The Future of Work in a Sustainable World. This conference brought together many thought leaders on the topic and really allowed us to celebrate our centennial. As we continue the celebration, we've launched this new series, and it's an initiative that I'm very grateful to Andrea Manillo for envisioning and really planning out. Andrea has opened his professional network to us, and we're going to enjoy hearing from so many of his friends and colleagues. He is the founding partner of IDA Capital, and he's also a member of the Gabelli School of Business Advisory Board and is the chairperson of Fordham University's London Center Board. This is the beginning of our series. To learn about other events, please visit our website, fordham.edu/100, because our series includes a lineup of many different speakers. Also, as you might imagine, many of our students are facing financial challenges, as is our school this year, due to lost jobs, internships, and economic challenges. So we ask you to please consider making a donation to our school by visiting our website, fordham.edu/Gabelli. A little bit about today's event. Today's event features Charles Gorra, CEO and founder of Rebag. It's particularly exciting because as people pivot in their careers, more people than ever are captivated by entrepreneurship and new innovative business models. At the Gabelli School of Business, our students envision our future, and we want them to explore all new ways of doing business and new business models. Today will surely give us a glimpse of the future. Our session will include a Q&A between Andrea and Charles, and then you'll also be invited to ask questions. Please put your questions in the chat, and we will get to them towards the end of the program. Thank you very much, and now it's my pleasure, without further delay, to turn it over to Andrea and Charles.
Thank you, Donna. It's a great honor to be here. It was very kind of you to introduce me. It's easy for me to serve to Fordham because I am an happy father. My son is a Gabelli School graduate, and I co-chaired with my wife, Brunella, the International Parents Leadership Council. So, I love to serve this wonderful institution, and it's true that I ask to friends and some colleagues, my mostly friends, to celebrate with us the centennial of Gabelli School. In fact, with Charles, who was born in Monaco, where my family has been living for 10 years now, I am good friends with great friends with his parents. So I'm delighted to have a new generation of great businessmen to stay on stage and to share with us their thoughts and their achievements. I will start. As you said, I prepared a few questions and I would love to share this with you. Okay. Charles, you are such a respected and admired figure among the young and innovative business leaders. You have been able to leverage your traditional and sound personal and education backgrounds, making innovative entrepreneurial choices. It would be interesting if you might share with us something about your family and education.
Sure, of course. Happy to be here. Thanks for the invite, Andrea, Donna, everyone. It's definitely a pleasure to be here, even in a remote setting. Happy to share some background. So I'm 36. I was born in Monaco. So I'm French citizen, grew up in Monaco on the Mediterranean Sea. I went to Paris when I was 17 in France we have undergraduate business school. It's a bit of a different concept, but I went to a college called HEC, which is our mini business school in France, and then started my career 2007 in investment banking. At the time I went to Goldman Sachs. I started pretty much the same day that Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers fell apart. Right, so pretty interesting time to join the financial industry. Somehow made my way for 3 years in Paris, as well as the London Goldman's offices. Did a couple of years in private equity in London as an investor in large cap private equity at TPG Capital. And then I came to the US 2012 with the desire to move to business school. I went to Harvard Business School, spent a couple of years there. And that was really the transition towards entrepreneurship for me. Spent a few months working at Rent the Runway, that some of you may know, or maybe your customers, which at the time was a two-year-old company. They launched a pretty innovative concept of digital dresses rental online. And I joined that for a bit in 2013. And then 2014, when I graduated, moved to New York. And I launched Rebag about 5 years ago now, just over 5 years. And at Rebag, you know, we are mostly a digital platform, and we're in the business of luxury resale. And basically we buy and sell handbags from, you know, Chanel, Hermes, Louis Vuitton. So happy to talk about that as well.
Charles, before going through the business model at we would like to know more about the animal spirits, as Keynes used to define the ability who makes entrepreneurship a successful achievement in the business life. You know, Fordham is one of the largest academic community in the United States. Therefore, share with us how your MBA was helpful in your entrepreneurship journey. And what brought you to move from a more traditional finance career with highly respected institutions to start a new business? Any advice for our students?
Yeah, of course, for me, business school was really critical in my personal journey. One of the other parameters is that I came from abroad, right? So I think when you come from abroad, there's also business school is a very important way to get integrated locally in the States, right? So to develop a community, a network. So I think that was pretty critical to me. And I'm sure it's the same at the Gabelli School, although I was in different school, you know, it's really immersion. It's very difficult, you know, to move from, I guess, finance or sort of standard job to sort of the risk level of entrepreneurship. Some people are able to do that overnight. For me, it was more of this transitional journey, and business school was very critical. Many reasons, you know, of course, one is the program, the school, the curriculum, if you will, the content. You know, these are great business schools. I'm sure there's a lot of courses on, you know, entrepreneurship and how to raise money and how to do a business plan. So these are very practical things that you can pick up in business school. But really, most importantly, I think it's the network of people you meet and you get exposed to, right? Is the fact that you're not alone, right? And to me, that's more important because entrepreneurship is a very lonely route. You know, I was, you know, sole founder, I had a co-founder initially, but you're basically alone or with one other person, right? And so it's great to be part of a bigger group. Because that's how you get to connect. I met a lot of people who had entrepreneurial successes where you can ask them their journeys, what they did right, what they did wrong. A lot of the people who helped me start this company, I met through business school, right? Pretty much everyone that matters. My main investor, I met through a professor in business school. who introduced me to that guy who became our angel investor. My first foray in startups at Rent the Runway, I got through business school because there were alumni, and that's how I met them through school. I met my co-founder through school. So everyone, and for me, it was very critical, not only from a business background, but more for the people that I met along the way. So for me, it was very important to go through that experience.
Let's talk about Rebag and its innovative digital moment. I don't remember anything digital in your background. Was it a big challenge for you?
Yeah, definitely, right? Because the main challenge you have, I guess, is legitimacy, right? Is the reality when you work. I worked, I went to business school undergraduate. I went, 5 years in finance. So I was reasonably prepared from a quantitative perspective. But as a lot of you may know, there's a very big difference between preparing models and Excel models on a spreadsheet and have it all made sense, in a report, and the actual materialization of all of that in day-to-day, right? And I think for me, when I started, when I knew nothing, in 2012, I don't know what a website is. I'm not a technical co-founder. I do not know how to build a site. I do not know how to write one line of code. And you'll hear that a lot. There's a big debate, right, especially in digital entrepreneurship. Do you need to be a technical founder or not, right? And of course, usually it's helpful, right? If you have the technical skills, it can only be helpful. But if you don't, which a lot of business founders like myself may not, there's things you can pick up along the way, right? So I'm still not able to write a line of code, but it's never been a problem as long as you're able to understand and communicate with engineers, right? So to me, that's the main thing I learned largely in business school, because there was a course of product management, and it's how to interact with engineers, with technical teams, to explain what your vision is, what the problem is, what the goals are, and then for them to be able to translate that on a technical roadmap. Right. And as long as you can do that, I think you can still get the legitimacy of the product ownership.
Can you tell us a little bit more, go through the business model at Rebag?
Yeah, so our businesses, we're in the business of a luxury resale, sometimes called secondhand, right? So in essence, it's something that's always existed in spirit. Basically, we buy and sell luxury bags. So we're very focused on a few things, right? And some of you may know or use competitive services, because luxury resale is now our biggest industry. What's very specific for us is that, one, we focus on only luxury accessories, mostly handbags, small accessories, small leather goods, because they're very high value. They're of the top brands, Chanel, Hermes, etc. And two, we have a very specific business model because we purchase the goods. Right. And that's a huge differentiator, because most of the services you will find, or the platforms that are out there, they're marketplaces, basically peer-to-peer marketplaces. So these are, basically eBay and the likes, right? Where someone can go and list an item and for someone else to purchase it. Right. Or you may have heard or use consignment venues, consignment platforms, right? Where basically you send them a product and they'll post it online and you'll wait forever. And then if and when that sells, you'll get a cut. And so what we're doing is we're paying upfront, right? So you go to our website or our app, rebag.com, send some pictures, we'll give you an instant quote. And if you like it, you send it to us, we just audit it, and we pay within a couple of days, right? So it's the idea of sort of fast monetization, if you will, versus the time that consignment or peer-to-peer may take, and the uncertainty that they take as well.
Okay. Gabelli is worldwide recognized and ranked to educate and form leaders with high civil conscience and deeply sensitive to the sustainable economy. And I know you as a leader with a strong and sensitive and environmental conscious approach how it is embodied in Rebag.
Yeah, so for sure, one of the main drivers of not just us, but I think the resale space in general over the last year is the sustainability theme, right? And you're absolutely correct that we don't produce any product. So in a way, it's really amazing that we create gold with dust, right? And I think that's one of the beauties of our business model is the underlying thesis is that everyone is sitting only in our assessment, only 1 out of 10 luxury owners right now are attempting to resell their items, right? So that means that 9 out of 10 users, they're just sitting on this pile of items. And so the benefit of our system and our digital platform is that we can create that liquidity. And you're spot on. Sustainability is very core to what we do because we operate a circular economy, right? Which in my opinion is where the whole world is moving. What people don't really know generally is that fashion or textile, I would say, is actually the second most polluting industry worldwide, right? And so there's a lot of waste. A lot of that being created in particular by fast fashion, right? So where historically over the last few years, because the trends in fashion keep changing, there's been this race for speed and more collection, more fast, and then more destruction. And then these goods just accumulate or really, frankly, they get destroyed. Yeah, so you probably read a lot of reports of brands putting stuff in landfills or even burning product. And I think what's been happening over the last few years, especially through social media now, is there's a whole movement for sort of a greener, more circular way of consuming. We're trying to break the model of production destruction, basically. And I think we're going to try and move now in more of a loop. And certainly resale is a big part of that.
Okay. Let's jump in the marketplace warfare. How was the big luxury brand's reaction and response to Rebag entry? Will you be the thorn in their side, which challenges them to change their business model? Shall the COVID-19 outbreak affect the market rules?
Yeah, so that's a lot of questions. So maybe at least a couple. So maybe we can start with brands. But yeah, it's an amazing question. So you're correct that brands, they're trying to figure out how to react to this, right? Because as every innovation, it's somehow disruptive. It's somehow unknown. Brands, especially luxury brands, have been doing an amazing job for decades, building brand equity, creating scarcity, creating envy from a brand perspective. And so now most of the brands initially do come and do address the whole luxury resale world with some form of skepticism, right? Because what brands are mostly scared is resale taking over their customers, right? I think that's the underlying fear. And that we converse with brands all the time, and we try to explain that this is actually not the case. For a few reasons. One is our buyers, people who buy from us, they're mostly a new generation of luxury buyers, right? Actually, the vast majority of our buyers, they've never purchased a full price product before from any of these brands. So to a certain extent, we're sort of brand discovery. And the idea is that the customers of resale today, they're the customers of the brands tomorrow, right? So they have an opportunity to talk to these people, to engage with these people through secondhand, right? And over time, these are consumers that they can grow and upsell into full price product, right? And on the other hand, you have sellers, a lot of the sellers that we deal with, we create instant liquidity. You know, what do you think those consumers do with the money that they create? The main reason that people mention in all our surveys, why are you selling, is to reinvest the proceeds. You know, it's to finance new items and new season and new purchases, right? So it's more, I like to think about this as a financing tool, right? It's really the same way that you buy a car, right? So that's what I like about this. We're not really inventing anything. We're transposing to the resale industry mechanics that have been working for decades in other industries, in particular electronics and automobile, right? If you're in the US, and I don't know how it's called in Italy, but I'm sure there's equivalent. In the US, there's something called Kelly Blue Book, right? That's basically the go-to place for figuring out the resale value of a car. When someone tries to buy a new car, they go to Kelly Blue Book to figure out how much is gonna resell. And then they're like, okay, if it resells $6,000 and I have to pay $20,000, really I'm spending only $14,000, right? And you're already checking the resale value and you're netting that. And you buy this car with an expectation on its resale value. And so really that's what we're applying to the luxury world, right? It's like, instead of just buying items and like, oh, I go to a store, I buy this, I buy that, is we're trying to move luxury purchases from, you know, purely instant, purely emotional, to somehow of an investment component, where you're like, yeah, maybe I love this bag, but also maybe I'd like to think about how much it keeps value. And once you know that, then you can help brands, because you can help them, the customers, they're financing their purchases, and you can help sell more new products, because customers try to price in the resale value, right? So ultimately, I think all of this merges. It's going to take time, but my expectation is that, and some of that has started, by the way, but in the next few years, you'll see a lot of brands, probably most brands or more department stores, they're gonna have some form of a resale component, right? It could be internal, it could be a partnership, it could be various formats, but I do believe that everything will be integrated.
Charles, before going to the number of questions we are receiving, I have a last one from my side, because I feel I am very sensitive to it. At Gabelli School, we give a great importance to global perspective, which is even a distinctive mark of the Jesuit education. And as the chair of the Globalization Council at the Gabelli, I was thrilled to have you with us today. You are a foreigner in the US, and how is to be a foreign founder in the US? Why did you create the business in the US?
Yeah, you know, there's a lot of opportunities here. You know, I'm here, you know, it's a bit of a cliche, but I think if you're here and you start a business, somehow you believe in the American dream, you know, you believe that you can just come here and make stuff happen, right? And I think, you know, there's certainly questions and debates if that's still true, but from my perspective, I've been lucky enough, you know, I came here, as you say, from a different country. I've been always welcome. I've been immersed, you know, in this universe. I've been given, you know, a lot of opportunities, and you know, the magic of the US for sure is that it's a huge market. You know, every market has pros and cons, but certainly here, it's probably the biggest consumer market in the world. You know, maybe now with China. So I think, you know, one investor who's our angel investor, you know, he told me one day that something that people underestimate is the sheer size of the US market, right? And the reality is whatever you're trying to create, because of the pure number of consumers that are here and also just the innovation that goes on, really anything you do here, if you do it well, can become pretty big, pretty fast. Right. And so I think that's why I'm here. And, you know, there's always hurdle everywhere. Like when you're a foreigner, there's a little of a bit more administrative work than if you're a local, but nothing insurmountable. And I've always find this very, very welcoming. And I think this place rewards, you know, whoever tries the hardest.
Great. We have a lot of questions, and I would like to hand over to Dean Rapaccioli to select some of them, because some of them are very interesting. I believe that going through it will be very, very helpful to everybody. Donna.
Thank you so much, Charles. I so appreciated the way the notions of the circular economy and sustainability are really embedded in your business model. So kudos to you. Thank you. A couple of questions are asking about the future and how are things changing for you given COVID-19? Are there particular products that now you can expand to? So again, you know, what's the future look like and are you going to have to pivot in response to the pandemic?
Yeah, for sure. Right now, this is top of mind. First of all, these days, before thinking about the future, we try to fix the present. That's a good place to start. I think everything that you see happening here, no one had planned. You know, there's every company in the world, you know, when you start the year, you do your business plan, right? Maybe you do a few cases, right? You do an upside case, you do a base case, you do a downside case, and you put some kind of probabilities. What happened there? No one has even put in their downside case. It's impossible. It's not happening like ever, right? So everyone everywhere was surprised, and overnight we had to change all our plans, right? So at the time, you know, when this happened early March, we're 150 people. We're 100 people in office and 50 people in stores, right? And so over the last couple of years, we have opened 9 stores. In LA, in Florida, in New York. And the reality is overnight, this got shut down, right? And so that was very hard to manage. It's very, very difficult. There's unfortunately a lot of people that are waiting for their job to resume. And we've been, you know, paying empty rent for 3 months. And I think it's crushing a lot of businesses, right? So right now, that's been the priority. We're lucky that we did the fundraising in the last couple of months. And I think we're lucky that we're well funded and we can sustain that hit. But I suspect many, especially small businesses, will never be able to reopen. So certainly we should try and help them as much as we can. From our perspective, what has been happened since then, I mean, we are expecting to reopen the stores eventually. Actually, we're reopening in Miami today, a couple stores. So that's a good place to start. They will reopen in totally different setting. You know, of course, they reopen with, you know, shorter hours, you know, social distancing, traffic limitations, you know, everyone wears masks and has. So there's all these new, this new way of life that I think we're going to have to learn. Nothing insurmountable, to be honest. I think what we're hearing from everyone on the ground is it was reasonably easy to put together and everyone is very... trying to really contribute to that. But for sure, it's a different world. And the reality is what we think and what we're seeing already is that I think this crisis is going to anticipate a lot of the digital transition, right? Which I guess is good for us and is going to be more difficult for offline businesses because if you see now, actually, our business has been very strong online over the last 2-3 months. Right. And pretty much we were able to recover most of what we lost from the stores. Right. And I think you see that all over the place, you know, grocery delivery. I've never ordered that much stuff in my life over the last. And I consider myself pretty digital. Right. I haven't been to the grocery stores in 3 months. Right. I haven't been to really any stores. Right. So I think this is just going to accelerate. It's going to accelerate the world by like 5 years. Right. And what I've seen, which I'm amazed, I've seen businesses that we work with that were very offline, not digital. In 2 months, suddenly you see, like my parents, who I think are on this call, they went on Zoom. They went on Zoom. Like, and I'm doing Zoom with my parents in Monaco and my sister in Latin America. Right. It's like the whole world has accelerated by 5 years. And so, we think for us, we're very well positioned to benefit from that.
Thank you. And I so appreciate your using the word accelerate as opposed to disrupt, because I think it just changes the way people can think about things and creates paths forward. You know, I'll ask this next one and then I'll give Andrea a chance, but this is kind of a follow-up to the original question. And it comes from Christopher, and he's curious about your thoughts on the shift from department stores to online sales and whether people are going to buy from a brand through an online department store like Net-a-Porter. And additionally, in hard luxury goods like watches, it seems like brands are entering the secondhand market, and he puts Watch Finder as an example, in an attempt to have greater control. Do you see that in your softer luxury market as well? So kind of a couple of questions all
great question. I guess Christopher is probably in the luxury or retail world, and he's very documented. So I'm glad to hear. So maybe we should chat. But you're spot on in your question. There's two things. One is department stores have been disrupted for many years. This is why I keep talking about acceleration, as you say. It's not a surprise. The businesses that are dying now, they were already in lethal mode. You know, I know it's terrible, obviously, because they all fell at the same time like a deck of cards. But, you know, Neiman Marcus, you know, J. Crew, JCPenney, they're all sharing the same characteristics. If you look at their like for likes over the last 5 or 10 years, certainly 5 years, they're all down. They're like single or double digit every year for the last, every quarter for the last 20 quarters, right? And these are companies that have shrunk because they have not evolved in the world of the online world. The main difference being that goods are now widely available online, right? So online makes a playing field for everyone, right? And the problem is you can buy the same thing from everywhere, mostly cheaper online, right? So why would you go to a department store, right? You have to do something else, right? Because if I'm going to go to a store, you need to offer me something more. Right, and usually more for luxury is a form of experiential shopping, right? Which is, you know, maybe, which is something like what they did at Nordstrom on 57th Avenue, which if you haven't been there, I definitely encourage you to visit. This is more of what the new department store of the 2020s will look like. Actually, if you get in, it doesn't look like a department store, right? You go and like there's like three bars and there's a leather repair store. And there's an exhibition. That's what retail is going to look like. You know, it's like, if I just go and buy stuff, I might as well do that online. It's going to be quicker. Right now it's coronavirus. I don't have to wear my mask. Most of the businesses, obviously for Amazon, et cetera, now it's moving to like same day, 1 hour delivery, 2 hour delivery. Like, why would I go anywhere? Right. So I think for commodities, it's very difficult to beat that. And for luxury players, it's going to be about offering, first of all, the footprint is going to reduce. There's no way around that. So the footprint is going to reduce. I've read, though, which is interesting. You see Nordstrom last month, they did 50% of their revenues online. Like, that's incredible. Like, obviously, it's a shrunk down number, right? Because they used to be, before the crisis, they used to do 35% of their sales online. Today, they do 50%. This is why I talk about a fact, like they went 15 points in 2 months. Again, not from the same base, but you get the idea, right? So that's accelerating. And I think you had your other question about secondhand. Yeah, I think watches is a great category to follow. They're way ahead of what's happening in other luxury categories. In particular in watches, resale has been very ubiquitous for many, many years. Right. So the same way that and actually a lot of what we do, we model around the watch industry. If you have watch lovers on this call, it's very common. First of all, same thing, new generations, they tend to go to secondhand by default. Right. So people like me, et cetera, they go to Tourneau, the pre-owned or watch finders and others. And then people who love watch, they're very much in this cycle. Mine, of course, there's collectors who just want to add, but there's a lot of like watches conserve value very well. They have some of these are very predictable asset. Some of these even appreciate in value if you can get access. And so it's been a very liquid market for resale. And I love to see what just so you know, for everyone, Watchfinder is basically the same concept as Rebag, but for watches. And a couple of years ago, they got acquired by Richemont Group. Right. And I think that's very interesting because now they're trying to integrate that in their bigger platform. And if you look at everything Richemont said, is exactly that. It's like, listen, we produce, we create those watches, but for some reason, customers now, they tend to go to those secondary platform with my watches, right? So I think I should be best placed to sell my own watches, right? So, and the way they did it is they went to buy this site and now they're sort of trying to integrate it. And I think ultimately that's what's gonna happen everywhere.
Charles, let me, I picked a couple of questions and then I will merge in just one for you. Are you deal with the counterfeits issue, which is pretty common in the luxury world? Second, people ask you, are you price and who is in charge, which is the most delicate thing, how you price your product in your...
Yeah, that's a great question. So on authenticity, you're correct. And this is, it's a huge issue, right? And there's a lot of counterfeits everywhere, especially for the luxury industry. That's one of the differentiations of Rebag, actually. One of the problems, if you deal peer-to-peer, right? Like if someone sells to another person, who knows? Who knows if that's product inauthentic? It's very hard to audit. So the way we do it is, when a user sells to us, we make a quote, but then that user sends the item to our warehouses, where that product goes through a physical authentication by our own trained authenticators, right? So every single product that we buy, it goes through the hand of a person, usually multiple persons, that basically audit them. And these are people that basically are experts that we recruited over the years, and that's their passion, that's their job. Just like you have watch experts, you have handbag experts. We look at every bag, we look at every serial number, every stitching, and we make a call. And then once it's verified, we purchase it, right? And I think the reason why people would sell or especially buy from us is because we go through that vetting process, and you have the peace of mind that what you buy from Rebag online or offline has gone through that safe process. On the pricing side, you're correct. Pricing, maybe with authentication, is the single most different thing that we have to do, right? In particular, because contrary to, if you're a peer-to-peer marketplace, right, or even a consignment venue, you don't have to take a view on the product, right? You create a platform and then people can trade to each other and you make a cut of whatever happens. So it's basically riskless, right, for you. Even in consignment, maybe you start at a price, but the reality, you just take a cut of what happens at the end, right? So it's basically all the risk is on the seller, right? For us, we're the buyer, we're paying our dollars, right? So we're basically writing instant cash to people. And then either we did well or we didn't, but our cost base is fixed and we better have done a good job at assessing that. Otherwise we're gonna lose money. And so the main IP that we're creating over the 5 years is basically we have a bunch of data by now. And that's where our system becomes really important and our digital tools, is that this industry is very opaque, right? So most customers do not really know what they own, and they even less know how much it's worth in the resale market, right? And so it's very hard for anyone to safely predict accurately the resale value of their goods. That's where we built our knowledge. We basically, for the last 5 years, collected pretty much any transactional data you can think of, right? And like, and we have an instant view, certainly for the market of the United States, of what's trading. It's basically, you know, this is where my finance background comes in. If you think about it as a prop trading algorithm, right? It's very much the same thing. Like there's an underlying asset and the asset is pre-owned luxury goods. And there's an arbitrage opportunity because owners don't really know how to value their own goods. And so with the IP that we created, the software that we created, we became really experts at valuation and we're able to capture that spread. And actually last year, we made that algorithm public, right? So that's really something where we changed the industry. In last October, our algorithm is called CLARE. It's called Comprehensive Luxury Appraisal Index for Resale. And now if you go to rebag.com, you don't even have to send pictures of your good or anything. You can self-query the database yourself. So we have tens of thousands of references And you know, when I was talking about Kelly Blue Book for cars, that's what we created for the luxury accessories category. So now you can go, I have a Louis Vuitton, I have a Speedy 30, that condition. And right there in a second, it gives you the price. So it's the first time in the world that there's transparency in the luxury prices through complete automation and software driven, right? And we think that's gonna change forever how people buy luxury goods, because now that you know you have these data points, you're gonna buy things and you're gonna check that in the first place, right? Because you're gonna go to Claire, see how much it resells, and then you're gonna decide what you buy in the first place because of what you saw in Claire.
So there's a question from Katie, which really links to what you were just talking about, around competition. It sounds like you created a proprietary platform that now competitors can maybe use to their advantage. Are you concerned about competition, and who do you see as your competition?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. You know, they're just like every market, you know, that's growing. It attracts participants. We're certainly not alone. I saw in the chat, there's many companies. Our most famous competitor is a company called RealReal that's now public. There's other players, you know, that are more peer-to-peer marketplaces. Mm-hmm. There's maybe now, I would say, 5 to 7 companies of large scale. And that's probably in the US only. Again, I think it goes back to what I was saying earlier. It really depends. We're very specific in what we do, right? So we're only in the luxury segment, and we offer this very unique model where we buy the product, right? So we're pretty unique from that perspective. Everything else that you see is largely either a peer-to-peer website or it's a consignment venue. Right, which means they probably can address a way larger share of the market that we can, right? But what we do is, what we believe is, the luxury segment is the most valuable, right? And so we want to be the best at what we do, right? And that has been our philosophy, is that we're Rebag, it's in the name. We're going to focus on accessories, we're going to focus on our core advantages, which is technology, which is a fast user experience, seamlessness. And that's what we do. And I think we try to do the best that we can. And there are certainly other platforms that are way more useful depending on your need, right? So right now, if your closet, for instance, we don't do apparel, and we will never do apparel, because our model is very high touch, is very expensive to fulfill. So there's many other websites that are very useful if you're trying to deal with apparel. That is not something we can do. But for the segment that we do cover, that's something that we try to be the best at. And one last thing I'd like to say on, you know, I like to say some, we compete against ourselves mostly, right? And we compete against what I call idleness. And this goes back to my previous point, 9 out of 10 current luxury owners, they're not reselling anything anywhere. So contrary to traditional industries, we're not really trying to steal share for anyone. Chances are, if you're in the 1 out of 10 people who are using a service and you're happy there, you're probably gonna stay there. What we're trying to talk to is those 9 out of 10 users that have never even thought about a resale. And an interesting statistic is that 60% of our sellers, they're first time sellers, right? They're people that it wouldn't even have occurred to them to do resale, because just the thought of it is daunting, right? But when we explain to them, listen, it takes 1 second, you do Claire, 20 seconds, and then next day you have dollars, they're like, okay. And by the way, I didn't talk about it, but in the stores, which unfortunately are temporarily closed, we're able to do that whole process in 1 hour, right? So that's extremely important. In our 9 stores, when they reopen, you don't even have to use the site if you don't want. You can go to the store 7 days a week, no appointment, bring any bag that you have, and we'll assess price and pay within an hour, right? So that's really, you see, when I say it's like, what's the downside? And I've seen people come with suitcases, you know, and I'm like, where? And like, yeah, I've had this for 20 years, but, you know, I mean, I don't want to take pictures, but now you're down there, and like, sure, I'll leave it there. I'll go and grab a coffee. And then when I come back, I have a few thousand dollars. Like, how good is that?
Amazing.
So one of the several questions are really talking on the more personal side. How did you decide to go from investment banking to luxury goods? You know, you're clearly very passionate about this. It seems like more of a calling than a job. You know, share with us a little bit about how that all transpired. And also, if you can tie in, we have some students that are on the call. If they want to get into this space, what advice would you have for them?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's really interesting that you say that because, you know, when I started this, I had no digital background and I had no luxury retail background, right? So basically, I had nothing other than the sense that I could achieve things, right? Which is probably the most important, right? So pretty much the short version is I think you can pick up these things, right? There's really nothing you need other than the belief that you can make things happen. Everything else you can pick up along the way. I'm still by no means a category expert. You know, we have people in our company that you can ask them about any bag of the last centuries. They will tell you everything about it. I cannot do that. I know enough to talk about it a little bit, but that's not really my main feature, right? So I think what's important for people is like all of this just, it's a journey. You know, if you told me when I moved in 2012, you're going to go to, after HBS, you're going to start a handbag resale company, that wouldn't even be in the top 1,000 answers that I would give you, right? So that's very interesting. It sort of became a mission over time. And I think, as you say, it's important to be passionate about what you do because startups, it's fully ubiquitous. It becomes your life. It's not a job, right? It's not a job, right? It's a mission. It never stops. You think about it every day. You dream about it. So you have to be, and it's a long journey. You know, I've been in this business, more than 5 years. I didn't make a dollar. I make a fraction of what I would have made in banking, right? But the reality is I wake up every day. And you know, it's not always easy. Like this morning, you know, we had some issues in our Soho store and you go through ups and downs. But thankfully, I'm surrounded by amazing people. Some of them have been with us with many, many years. So it's amazing to be, company building is largely a human experience. You know, there's many people that we met 5 years ago. Actually, out of our top 10, first 10 employees, I believe 6 are still there, right? So it's really important. It's more of a family, if you will. Sometimes you fight a little bit and, you know, it's like every family. But over time, it's very different than going to a job and, when the job closes, you go back to your thing. And it's so much embraced in your life. The people, the themes, for sure it becomes very, very ubiquitous with everything you do.
It's really been incredible. I want to give my colleague Andrea the opportunity to ask one last question and then we'll have a closing message. But Andrea, please.
Yeah, well, listening to Charles, even I've heard the story, but few times, but not so in details as we had the opportunity today, reminds me one story I lived many years ago. I met one of the family who owned El Corte Inglés. El Corte Inglés is the largest stores chains in Europe and the fourth largest in the world. And they were a little fabric shop, tissues. El Corte Inglés means the Spanish cut, serving tailors. And you know, he explained to me, you know what makes the difference? There is no country in the world where a single store has such a sort of monopolist position as they have in Spain. Because we start offering to our clients that they had for 48 hours the opportunity to give us back if they were not happy of their purchase. So we guaranteed the best quality in the market. The people were so confident, confident on us, they start that they wanted to buy everything from us. And we were obliged to transform our little shop is one of the most successful store chain and story in the store business. So my last question is, Charles, I'm saying it the French way. Do you think that Rebag is the first step of maybe you will be in the future a different type of product using the same model?
Yeah, I think you're correct. You know, as I said, we're 5 year old. Certainly, we're here to last. We're very equipped, you know, with capital, with a great team, with a great software and capabilities. And we do think the resale industry, you know, it's only getting bigger. You know, every day that passes, it's getting bigger and bigger. Whatever projection you look at, 2, 3, 4 times, I think it's in 5, 10 years, it's going to be maybe 10 times as big. So there's going to be a lot of opportunities, not just for us, for a lot of companies. And for sure, eventually, we'll try to capture a bigger piece of this pie. And you're actually spot on. We're certainly looking at a few. Right now, we do bags and accessories, small leather goods. Of course, there's many other categories we can think about doing. I expect that if you look at Rebag in a few years from now, you'll see more components to that. And bear in mind, right now we're only in the US, right? So I'm not even talking about other opportunities, you know, Europe, Asia, like anywhere where there's a luxury product, there's a possibility to build a Rebag eventually. So I think the opportunity is really endless. But for us, it's more self-discipline, you know, some capital constraints. Sometimes what kills startups is, you know, going too big too fast. So we've been pretty focused. We've been pretty focused on one country, one product. We do expect to accelerate that. And over time, we'll see where we are in 5 years from now.
Wow.
Thank you so much. This has been wonderful. Really, we hope that you'll come back again. Because there's so many questions here.
It's a pleasure. I appreciate the invite.
I want to invite my colleague, Andrew Auslander, to close us out. But thank you all.
Thank you. Hi, I'm Andrew Auslander. I have the honor of being the co-chair of the Value Investing Group at the CFA Society of New York. I want to thank everyone who made today possible. Thank you to Andrea Manillo. You did a great job of interviewing Charles. Thank you very much, Charles, Charles Gorra, who provided insightful comments on entrepreneurship. That was great. I want to thank Donna Rapacoli, the Dean of the Fordham University's Gabelli School of Business, for your leadership in creating this Centennial Speaker Series. A big thank you to Fordham University's Gabelli Center for Global Security Analysis for hosting today's event, and to the Museum of American Finance for their generous sponsorship. The CFA Society of New York has been bringing unbiased content and education to financial professionals for over 80 years. We have more than 11,000 members and many thought-provoking events every month. You don't have to be a CFA charter holder to join the society and receive a discount to all of these events. If interested, visit cfany.org for more information. Thank you very much and have a great rest of the day.